thank you so much for coming out to this wonderful event today. This is the culmination of Speechcraft here at BCC. My name is Ryan Levesque. I am the president of the Fall River Innovators Toastmasters Club. And as most of you know, we are the organization that has been providing the educational component of Speechcraft here in collaboration with Bristol Community College. So I want to thank all of you for coming out today. For those of you who came out to support the students, whether you're from the university or friends and family, we appreciate having you here. And I just want to say, I hope that this is definitely the first Speechcraft that we've ever done here, but I hope it's not the last. And while this is the culmination of our event, it's not the end of our growth and our development as leaders. And that goes for the Speechcraft team as well as all of our students who have made such tremendous growth over the past 6 weeks. It's been really exciting. I know we've said this many times, but it's been truly exciting to watch the growth and development week after week. I want to thank our Speechcraft team for coming out as well to support us. What we're going to do today is going to be very similar to what's happened over the past 6 weeks with one key difference. And that difference is that the Speechcraft team is going to be taking a backseat role today. And that means the students are going to be stepping up and filling the leadership roles during the meeting, with the exception of me as the Toastmaster, as your MC for the day. That being said, I have the great honor to introduce to all of you, to share a few words, the president of this great college, John J. Sprague. Mr. Sprague.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. This is a terrific event for the college. We're proud and honored to be hosting it and to have our participants so active in this program. You know, in my career, I must say, as I watch students and professionals speak at events, sometimes you have 5 seconds notice, and sometimes you have 5 months notice to prepare a formal speech. But in any event, you are going to be called upon to explain yourself in some fashion. And this is a wonderful experience for you. Similarly to writing, you're going to, no matter what position you're going to find yourself in years from now, you're going to have to explain your views and your arguments. And to do it, be able to articulate them in effective fashion. So this is a very important part of your education here at BCC, and that's why I'm so glad that we have this partnership with Toastmasters International as well as Speechcraft to provide us with the support that we need, to provide you with the support you need to get this training. So I'm anxious to say hello and goodbye. I want to get off the stage and let you continue with your good work. I'm not sure if my schedule is going to allow me to stay the whole time, but I do wish you well. I congratulate each and every one of you for partaking in this exercise. You're going to find, sometimes, you know, when you fill out an evaluation right after the class, one of the complaints I have about those evaluations, although they're important, is that you really don't appreciate the value of the class until much later. The value of what BCC did for you until years later. I still have alumni that come to me and say, you know, I wouldn't be where I am without BCC, but I didn't recognize it at the time. And the same for today. I wish you well. You're going to appreciate the value that you have earned, the great skills that you are honing, continue to hone the rest of your life. Good luck, and I hope it's a terrific program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, President Sprague. Wonderful model of leadership and excellent communication here at the college. So glad you could join us today. I want to also acknowledge a couple of other people here at the college. Kathleen Burns, the Director of Student Life, who unfortunately wasn't able to be with us here today. But we are honored to have the Assistant Director of Student Life, Marianne Laguiadere. Thank you for being here. And there are two other functionaries that I'd like to introduce to you at this time who will be helping us stay on track and improving our skills throughout the meeting. The first is our timer today, Allison Taylor. And Allison is going to say a few words about the role of timer and what she'll be doing for us today. Allison.
So I'm Allison. I will be taking the role as the timer, so basically keeping track of making sure we're staying on track within our agenda that we have already created. When you come up to give your speeches, I will give you a green card once you have already reached like the minimum time, and then a yellow for when you get a little more closer to being too long, and then a red when you should probably start wrapping it up and ending.
And now I would like to introduce our grammarian and wordmaster for the day, Amy Blanchett. Welcome, Amy.
So good afternoon. I'll be your grammarian for the day. The first rule of the grammarian is to present the word of the day, which is resilient. Resilient means able to withstand or recover quickly from difficult conditions. A sample sentence would be, babies are generally far more resilient than new parents realize. The second definition, able to recoil or spring back into shape after bending, stretching, or being compressed. A shoe with resilient cushioning. So that is the word of the day. I will keep track of how many times you use it in your speeches when you come up here and you do your evaluations. In addition to that role, I will be counting how many times you say the word so, and you repeat a word, you have a false start, an incomplete sentence, or a filler word. So that is my role, and can we hear you guys speak? Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. So we had a couple of changes to our program today, that being that our timer did not show up and our grammarian was not able to be here as well. But the fact that Allison and Amy both stepped up to those roles shows just how resilient the students here at BCC are. We're going to now move into the part of the meeting that we all know as table topics. And for those who are not familiar with it, as President Sprague said, there are times that we will be called to speak and we may not have the opportunity to prepare. That's what table topics is all about. We have our table topic master who will come up and put out a challenge, a topic for us to speak upon, and he will call on a student to come up for 1 to 2 minutes and share a response. Our table topics master today is Mr. Ryan Aruda. Please help me welcome him now. Ryan.
All right. Today's table topics, now we get into the fun part. So I'm gonna need some volunteers. Who wants to volunteer first? All right, Daniel, come on down. I want to let you know if you didn't volunteer, you were going to end up being picked because you take the All right. Pick a number, 1 to 6. 5. 5. All right. Given an unlimited amount of money. Well, not unlimited, a reasonable amount of money. You can have an economic car or a flashy car. Which would you choose and why?
Economic car. I would have an economic car. Because why would I waste such money on such flattery? Well, that money could be well spent anywhere else. An economic car could have good gas mileage. We have an Prius, for example, or a Nissan Leaf, hybrid and electric type cars. With these types of cars, you can not only save gas and also money. With these nice, pretty cars from Ferraris to Trans Ams, they might not be able to save on fuel. What we need to consider is our reduction on carbon footprints that each of us individually contribute to our environment. Sure, you save money in the meantime, but it's not about the money. It's about what difference that you can make that will create our environment so we can all live in a better world. Thank you.
Daniel was the only hand that was up. I'm gonna start picking people. And I don't know everybody's names, so I'm pretty much gonna go off of names that I know. So Chris, come on up. Thank you, Chris. Please don't be mad. All right, pick a number, 1 to 6. 5 is out of the question.
1 through 6?
1 through 6. No.
3.
3. All right. What's your best friend's name?
My best friend's name?
Yep.
Bruce Glenn.
All right. Bruce Glenn. Favorite female celebrity?
Favorite female celebrity? I don't want TV, believe it or not. I don't want television, so that's difficult.
All right. So Katy Perry is your favorite female. All right. So Bruce met Katy Perry at a Katy Perry concert, and now they're getting married. You're going to be Bruce's best man, and you're going to give a best man's toast right now.
Okay. Well, thank you everyone for coming, and I just wanted to let you know that Bruce and Katie are very happy that everyone could be here. It was a kind of strange how they met at the concert, and it was love at first sight as she gazed upon him out in the crowd and had him pulled up on the stage and sang a love song to him. And from there, you know, they were being chased around the world by the paparazzi as they were being viewed and love that could only be told in certain stories. And now she's pregnant and about to have kids. And they're writing a book about their life together. And that's all I get. Thank you for coming.
Come on down, Kevin. Two. All right. This might be a little tough for you because you're on the younger side, but why don't you tell the audience who was the best boy band of the 90s?
By far, I think the best boy band of the 90s was NSYNC. It was not just known for its famous song Bye Bye Bye, but it also was what started Justin Timberlake out of his depression of having to deal with the problems of being known as that Disney World kid. And I really feel that it's, other than just starting Justin Timberlake's legacy, it also helped be really a symbol of what the 90s was about. It was about the poppy, like the hip hop beat. It was a symbol of prosperity, of having fun, and I really think it captured that whole era really well.
Anybody want to volunteer? Still no volunteers? All right. Come on down, Patrick.
Could I stood up?
Thank you. All right, so we got one or four.
I'm gonna go with four.
Four? All right. This one's a little bit easier.
Okay.
Why community college?
Well, the reason why I chose community college personally is because, interestingly enough, Ryan actually did a speech about this just last week as why community college, other than being in the military, is one of the better options for people just starting out in the higher education. And so my reasons for choosing a community college is the fact that when I initially graduated high school and went to the military myself, I was unsure of exactly what it is that I wanted to pursue for a career. So in order to do that and not miss out on any time that I could be spending in school, I decided to go to community college and enroll myself in general studies, which kind of gave me a foot in the door, which allowed me to feel around in different areas of study. I could have done the same thing at a university or a higher level, but if I had gone to one of those schools, I would have ended up paying possibly $20,000 per year compared to less than $10,000 a year here at Bristol Community College. And that is why I chose Community College.
All right, I'm running out of names, so I'm gonna go off this list to pick people. I got your names right here. All right, how about Joanna? So far has been the best speech or topic that you've heard so far at Toastmasters?
I think that would be the one, the table topic that we just heard right now about community college. I completely agree with everything you said. It does help to start your education and get your career going. I believe that community college is, not only is it affordable, but it's also more flexible for people who need to work, or if you're a student who's a parent, or if you can't afford to live on campus, and or even move out of state. But yes, that would be my choice for the best speech that I've heard so far.
All right, last one. Any volunteers, real quick? No one wants to finish it out? All right, here we go. We're gonna go with Cynthia. Best for last for you. So Chris gave us a toast earlier about his best friend marrying Katy Perry.
Oh.
We're gonna have a toast, but it's gonna be a little bit easier this time. Today is our graduation. Technically, it's called the graduation, right? All right. So our graduation from Speechcraft. So let's give a toast to everyone that's here that participated going forward.
Cheers to everyone here. Yes. Congratulations. We made it. 6 weeks were weeks of learning, laughing, listening, and now speaking what we have learned this whole 6 weeks. I appreciate you all, and I thank you all for helping me to be a part of this as student ambassadors, student senators as well. Congratulations to all.
Thank you. All right, so that concludes my table topics, and I'd like to turn the floor over to our Toastmaster, Mr. Ryan Levesque.
Great job, Ryan. Those were really fun, and all the speakers did a great job as well. We are now going to move into our prepared speeches for the day. We have 5 prepared speakers. And what we've been doing throughout Speechcraft is every week giving speeches that are working on a different skill, a different aspect of speaking. And so this week, our students were working on vocal variety. So they'll be giving a speech and trying to incorporate into their speech vocal dynamics, speed, pitch, rate, the quality of voice, all of those things into their speeches. And our first speaker today is Patrick Lever. Patrick is going to be speaking on the importance of communication. Let's welcome Patrick.
Thank you very much, Ryan. So, hello everybody, my name is Patrick Lever. I'm a general study student here at BCC. And as Ryan said, today my speech is going to be on the importance of communication. So many people, if not everybody in this room, has heard the saying before, you don't know what you've got until it's gone. Now you may be wondering how I can incorporate that saying into a speech on communication. Well, my first topic that I'm going to be covering in terms of communication is the importance of relationships and interactions with communication. Because in this era of high-tech society, and where everybody's on their cell phones, iPads, computers,
we're losing a lot of our interactions and communication relationships with people. And when people say you don't know what you have until it's gone, we go home, we automatically, most of us go straight to our room, go on our laptop to do our homework, whatever reason is that you're on that electronic device. When outside, for example, for me, at my house, my grandparents are out in the living room watching TV in the kitchen cooking, and recently it dawned on me, they're only getting older and I'm only getting older, so I'm losing out on this valuable time that I have with my grandparents. So recently I decided to make the change in my life to dump my electronics and go spend time learning how to cook and taking care of the lawn, watch soccer with my grandfather. And it's not just your grandparents, but your siblings, your younger siblings or older siblings, and your parents as well as your friends. And then with interactions, you have your interactions with nature, because so many people walking around here on campus are just buried on their phone, walking around, not looking, and they'll bump into somebody, and they won't even say sorry. But that's not the only thing. They're missing out on so much of the beauty that we have here on campus, because you have the path that goes around the pond, and what many people don't know is there's also paths that lead into the forest that you can go if you have an hour between classes. My second topic is the importance of communication itself, because communication is a skill that many people are losing, because they don't know how to start a conversation. They don't know how to ask somebody to go out on a date anymore without doing it over email or Facebook in particular. And they don't know how to communicate with each other when they're at a birthday party or when they're simply hanging out with their friends, because most of the time they're just communicating with each other on the phone. I've seen multiple times people sitting on the couch together and they both just, they'll send messages to each other and they'll laugh, LOL. Look at this picture that I just saw. And that's what communication has turned into. And the last topic that I'm gonna be talking in terms of communication is the importance of communication literacy. When I was writing my essay, or speech I should say, for today, I did some research on literacy. And the numbers that I found for the United States in literacy ranged from being the 7th most literate country in the world to the 17th most literate country in the world. Now, whichever of those numbers is true, regardless, even being number 7 is not that great of a country to be for what we deem to be the greatest country on earth. And my belief in that is because, as I said, going back to communications and texting and messaging, is that people are only so busy saying LOL and using acronyms and synonyms and emojis, they're not spending their time developing their words. They're not spending time, as we have these last 6 weeks, developing their speechcraft. And when it comes time to be in college and write a 6-page paper or 8-page paper, it's not coming as easily to them because they didn't spend as much time reading as we all did when we were younger. They didn't spend as much time reading, whether it be a book or the cereal box, because everybody nowadays is just so much time spending on Facebook or watching their latest YouTube or play video games. And to me, those are the three most important reasons why communication is important. Thank you guys for your time.
Thank you so much, Patrick. That was excellent. Our second speaker today is Kevin P. Furtado. And Kevin is going to be sharing with us what Toastmasters has taught me. What Toastmasters has taught me, Kevin P. Furtado.
I've decided to do something rather interesting today and try to summarize 6 weeks of learning into roughly 3 minutes and possibly put CJ out of a job. It's kind of funny that I would bring up CJ though, because he gave me my first important lesson. He said, apparel, the way you look, your deportment, it's everything. You can't just be wearing a sweatshirt and a graphic tee and think people respect you. And on that note, man, I am a hypocrite. Okay, see what I mean? Now, the next interesting point that I was taught came from Sarah, and she said that you've got to know your audience, be it that they're 5 years old, or they're 50 years old, or 105. Case in point, I think I have a way to prove this. How about this? President Spraga, if you could please, I knew you would be in this audience today, so I knew I would have to choose you. Please name a card, any card that would be in a regular 52 card deck. Yeah, just yell it out loud.
Jack of Spades.
Jack of Spades. Excellent choice. You see, sir, I knew beforehand that you would choose that because every card is facing one way except for one. And because I knew my audience, I knew it would be the Jack of Spades. Wow. After Sarah spoke, though, it came down to Carlos. And he taught us that although it's good to know your street cred, or it's good to know what you're talking about, you don't always have to. So as long as you can go off your gut and, pardon my phrase, but BS it, chances are you're gonna make it after all. And yes, that was a Mary Tyler Moore reference. Case in point, I've just shuffled this deck, and all I know is the first card is the Five of Diamonds. I would have no idea that the next card could be the Eight of Spades. Again, clubs. See what I mean? Even if, though, the next card was the Eight of, there would be no way still, though, that I could know if the next card was the Jack of Hearts. And likewise, I could have no idea that the next card would be the Ace of Spades. Of course, I'm just going off my gut. There's no way I could know. It's all random. But I mean, still. I guess when it boiled down to it, the final and most important speech that I got came from CJ. And it was his final one, incredibly enough. Am I kidding you people? Do you think that the first and most important thing you'd learn would be straight up ahead? You have to wait 5 weeks to do it? But anyway, CJ taught us about vocal tone. If you don't mind helping, please, I'm going to shuffle this deck of cards. And I just want you to very loudly, as if you are pissed off at me for talking about you earlier, yell stop, okay? Just at any point, CJ.
Stop!
Perfect, thank you. And we have dedicated a card to this speech from CJ, this one-word speech. Now again, please say the same word, stop, but this time softer, as if you don't really care, as if you don't really care what card it is. Perfect. Now we have a different card because of a different speech. And now you can easily, visually see that two cards, two different speeches came from the same word, but just being said in two different ways. However, when I get down to the nitty-gritty of it, I guess it wasn't just two speeches, but dozens of speeches over the course of 6 weeks that have brought me to where I am, to the point where I'm no longer nervous speaking in front of big crowds, and where I feel that I've done almost a complete 180. To conclude, I'd like to say that really, I would not be where I am today if it were not for the excellent help of everyone here at Toastmasters. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. That was a lot of fun. I'm just grateful that you didn't call me out as the Joker. Our third speaker today is Davina Lara, and her speech is entitled Time. Let's welcome Davina.
Hi everyone, my name is Davina. I named my speakers Time for the reason that today's day, as Patrick mentioned today, that was today is, we don't have time. We working so hard today that we don't have time for anything. We don't have time for our children. We don't have time to sit down and communicate with our children. We just working. We look like us a robot. I'm going to base my speaker about that. How we can improve our time and dedicate our time and be resilient and be more passionate about our children and sit down and dedicate 2-3 minutes more within and be what's going on within at school and love them even more. That's what my speaker was talking about today, about those special time. Thank you.
Thank you, Davina. Our fourth speaker today is Cynthia Fencobley, and Cynthia's speech today is called Unconditional Love. So let's show Cynthia some love. Come on.
Greetings. There's a song with the lyrics that include, or the lyrics that go, I wanna be loved, not for who you think I am, not what you want me to be. Could you love me for me? Real love, with no strings attached. There's more, but that's not for this moment. When I was growing up, there was love in my home, but the unconditional part of that was not distributed evenly or equally, you know, a little on an uneven scale, if you will. Middle child syndrome. I'm the middle child. So I did live that. I did feel it, and it was not a good feeling. However, I made it through. My resiliency through that ordeal helped me to become the most creative person that I could have made myself. It taught me how to love more, myself more, and others more. And it showed me what I was missing as I was growing up. I made some mistakes in life, as we all do, but there are two mistakes that I didn't make: getting married to my wonderful husband and having children, two of them in the audience. My husband and I, we chose to raise our family. It was a choice that we made together, to raise our family unconditionally. We allow our children, or we allowed them, as adults we still allow them, to express their emotions. We allow them to acknowledge their emotions, to process the emotion, to flow with it, which means go through the motions, and flow on with life. We chose those reasons to do that, because there should not be a condition on love whatsoever. If we're allowed to balance our emotions, allowed to process our emotions, allowed to feel, allowed to be ourselves, who we are, unconditional love would be for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Cynthia. Our fifth and final student speaker this afternoon is a young man who has really embraced the Speechcraft program and actively participated in every step of the way. His name is Daniel T. Borden, and the title of Daniel's speech is Synchronicity of the Unknown. Let's welcome Daniel.
Synchronicity. What is it? What does it have to do with life? The first thing that comes to mind, it's just a misunderstanding of coincidence. But coincidence, think about this for a second. If you have two bar graphs that show similar data, one with oil field trends and the other with economic growth of a community college, they might be similar in nature of their graphs, but the concepts are completely foreign to each other. With synchronicity, It's based on the human experience. But what by the human experience do I mean? It's an untold story to this day, for me personally, of a story of patience, resilience, discipline, and perseverance. Each with its own key moment. I have been a very impatient person for the majority of my life. I came to Bristol Community College not knowing anything, wanting to get out as soon as I can. I'm sure a lot of you know, I'm very interested in the University of Massachusetts Amherst. But after realizing they wanted to take a look at my high school transcript, I was starting to think, maybe I should stay here and go through the full BCC experience and to graduate from Bristol Community College. So I held off from applying and I decided to stay, which became the best decision in my life. The next thing I learned was one of the most important virtues, resilience. I took a sociology course with Professor Nancy E. Wood about sustainability, and the key phrase that just kept being repeated was resilience. It just stuck to me. Based on a series of events that occurred in my life all over the place, I had to learn very quickly to apply that new knowledge about myself. Resilience, just need to keep standing up. If I get knocked down, just get back up again, and no matter what, never give up until the end. I kept going, but at one point, I felt like something wasn't right. The equation wasn't adding up together. Got patient enough. I'm learning resilience, but what was missing? I found out very recently, within the last few weeks, because the answer was thrown right into my face when I least expected it. One of those moments, and when you see it, is this a coincidence? No, can't be a coincidence. Everything I experienced leading up to that was not a coincidence. The word itself was discipline. And it was actually talked to by a fellow Toastmasters at the previous meeting, who unfortunately is not here today. I wish he was. But I was actually a speech evaluator for his presentation, and I just broke down crying at that point. Because when I know something just really means special to me, the tears stopped flowing of joy. The answer was given right in front. Couldn't believe it. But what do I do with this? Because I need to get to perseverance. What is it, though? Perseverance is something, again, I'm not too sure how to explain it, because to experience it, I need to be able to experience discipline myself. And with all the obstacles that are between in my control, not in my control, I must learn to work with everything, with being patient, just being resilient, making sure not just to hang on, but also to thrive. Because if I can thrive, I can be perseverance and be able to be successful in my life and what I want to achieve. Now, going back to the whole bar graph idea, you have oil stocks and you have trends, the community college, not related. But you have a buildup of experiences that change one's life.
That's when you need to stop and think for a moment. Is synchronicity real? I want everyone in the audience today to think about that. What does this mean to you? Whether something has happened that might be positive or negative, I'm talking about long term. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Daniel, for that inspirational speech. In addition to our five student speakers today, we have the honor of having a guest speaker here with us. She is the Club Growth Director for District 31 Toastmasters. And what that means is that she is responsible for helping new clubs get started all across Eastern Massachusetts, Central Massachusetts, and all of Rhode Island. Her name is Stacy Shipman, and she is a distinguished Toastmaster. She's going to be speaking with us today on face-to-face. I'm sorry.
Your presence is a gift. Your presence is a gift.
Okay, and the title of her presentation today is Your Presence is a Gift. Let's welcome Stacy Shipman.
Wow. Those were incredible speeches and table topics for that matter. And so much of what I heard from all of you, including the president and his remarks about expressing your views about the importance of communication to build relationships, the creativity that you showed with the cards and using that as a metaphor for what you've learned, singing, I mean, it took me years. And I'm still not as comfortable as what I've seen from some of you. So when CJ asked me to be here today, he sent me an email and he said, we're having our graduation. We've narrowed it down to the three speakers that we think would be the best. Are you available on April 10th? And my first thought was, wow, what an honor. And my second thought was, was I the first one he asked or the third one he asked? But it's a pleasure to be here, and it's really a pleasure to hear all of you. I've been a member of Toastmasters for a little more than 10 years now. And when I first started, I was transitioning out of my corporate job to pursue my dream of owning a business. Now, I spent the first half of my career in market research. It was very quiet. I developed surveys, I wrote reports, and I didn't have to do a lot of public speaking or presenting in small groups. And I quite liked it that way. But when I decided to start my own business, I very quickly learned that that quiet was not going to help me achieve my dreams. And that's when I joined Toastmasters and got really involved. But what I've learned is so much more than that. It's more than talking to people. It's more than pitching ideas to people or expressing your views to people. At the core of it all is connection. Last fall, a colleague and I met at a local Panera. I live up in Weymouth. So we were in Hingham and we were at a Panera. It was a really warm, sunny day, so we were sitting outside. And it was a few weeks before the presidential election. So after we talked about business, we started talking about all of the, you know, things going on in the world. And our conversation very quickly turned from upbeat and positive to not so upbeat and kind of negative. And with all that, I could feel my whole body just caving in on itself, and I was slouching in my chair. And as we were talking, all of a sudden, out of the corner of my eye, I noticed this young girl. She stopped by our table. She had the cutest light brown curls that fell by her shoulders, a lavender dress, and she stood by our table, and she looked at me, and she saw my water bottle, this one exactly, sitting right there on the table. She looked at me, and she said, I love your water bottle. And I looked down at her, and I was like, well, thank you. Is purple your favorite color? She looked at me, she's like, yeah, purple's my favorite color. I was like, it's my favorite color, too. And her mom looked, and she's like, oh, all she has talked about for the last half an hour, looking through the window at your table, is that purple water bottle. And I smiled, and I thought it was funny, it was cute, I didn't really know what else to say. And then this young girl and her mom walked away. And as they did, I turned in my chair to watch them go. This young girl captivated me. And as I watched them walk away, the little girl turned back, looked at my friend Jackie and I, and blew us a kiss. I whipped back around in my chair. I looked at Jackie and I said, "Oh my God, Jackie, did you just see that? She just blew us a kiss." She just blew us a kiss. And I couldn't get that kiss out of my brain. And I kept asking myself, why is this attaching itself to me so much? And the more I thought about it, the more I analyzed it, I'm an analyzer, and the more I thought about it, I realized it was her presence. She approached us in the most genuine way. She knew exactly what she wanted to say. "I like your water bottle." She expressed herself from here. And with that presence, her presence was a gift, because in those moments, she shifted my mood right away. I sat taller, I had a smile on my face, I forgot about the negative conversation that my friend and I were having. And more importantly, she made me wonder how the heck I could go get her her own purple water bottle before her and her mom drove away. Now, I wasn't able to get her a purple water bottle. But in that moment, I realized that her presence was a gift, and that's what really captivated me, because she had what, ever since I've joined Toastmasters, and really my whole life, I've been searching for. The ability to be genuinely me. The ability to express myself from here so that I can create those connections. And ultimately, to have influence. To know that my ideas are being heard, that I'm contributing, if personally or professionally. And to move people into action so that they say, "How can I buy from you?" So when I joined Toastmasters, I didn't have any of that. I used to wear my hair slicked back, tight in a bun. Wore all black. And then I worked with a coach and she said, "You know, you need to wear pink, and you need to let your hair down, and you need to soften." And I was like, "Fooey, you." But over time, what communication has taught me and what Toastmasters has given me is a platform to learn how to express myself. Myself. Not the way I'm supposed to be, not what other people want me to be. Who I am. What do I believe? What do I want for my life? Who are the people that I want to hang out with? And how do I want to be around them? One of the most important things, you know, this concept of blowing kisses. When I tell that story, a lot of people are like, "Yeah, yeah, blowing kisses, I'm never going to blow a kiss." But there are so many different ways that we can do that. And speaking and presenting is one way. Because if you do have ideas, an interesting way of approaching life, that's a gift, that's a kiss. It's a way to make someone's life better. And I learned that the hard way. Part of my work now is professional speaking. I talk about communication, I talk about stress management. And I was delivering a presentation, this was a number of years ago, at a local library, and I kind of went in with a, "You know, it's late, and I want to go to bed, and I don't like being out too late," and not in a very good space. And I gave my presentation, and I ended it with a guided relaxation. And at the end, as I was packing up to go, one of the women approached me. She had tears in her eyes. I was like, "Oh my God, are you okay? Is everything okay?" And she looked at me and she said, "You know, I've lived with chronic pain for most of my adult life. And for the 15 minutes that you guided us through that relaxation activity, I didn't have any pain." And it was that moment that shifted my entire perspective of what communication is, what presenting is, what speaking is, what just talking one-on-one is all about. It's not about me and all my head trash. It's about the gifts that I have to give people, the knowledge, the tools, the strategies, the ideas that can create something bigger than myself. Your presence is a gift. Your ideas are a gift. Your knowledge is a gift. And when we can see it that way and present ourselves fully, our ideas fully, whether they're fully formed, whether they're ridiculous, off the wall. Someone once told me, "Stacey, you gotta stop analyzing things and just get your ideas out there. It doesn't matter if they're fully formed, they can be a jumping off point for something that is fully formed." Oh, that That's novel. But your presence is a gift. A few years ago, I did a program similar to this, actually. It was 8 weeks, but it was the youth program, so it was high school students. And I didn't have any experience with high school students. I'm not a parent. And the last time I really had any experience with teenagers was when I was a teenager. And I just knew what I was like as a teenager, so I was really scared of who was going to be in the audience. But we went through this program, and on the last night, I really struggled. It was a graduation, similar to this. Everybody gave a presentation. We invited the parents, some of our Toastmasters, community members. And I sat and I wondered, did I make a difference? Was I able to do what I really wanted to do by delivering this program? I didn't know, because week after week, the kids were more interested in, you know, texting their friends after school or finding out if they could order a pizza to have brought into the program because they were hungry. It's like, what's happening? Nobody wants to give a speech. What is happening? But as I listened to each one of them come up, and they gave a 2-minute presentation that night, and I heard them talk about how they're more comfortable now making eye contact with people when they're talking to them. Or how they met new friends that they would not have met otherwise, and they would have just passed with their head down in the hall. But now they had new friends because of the 8-week experience that they participated in together, because they wanted to do it again in order to have that experience. I knew that what we had presented mattered. Our presence, my co-facilitator and I, our presence in that moment was a gift. I think more than ever, right now, today, in today's world, society, your small communities, large communities, we need people who can be present, who can express themselves in a genuine way, who have ideas and ways that we can make our world better and have the courage to express them. We need people to listen. Cynthia, yes? You talked about laughing, learning, listening.
Yes.
We need people who can listen, to be there for others, not just verbalizing what's in our mind, but allowing other people to verbalize what's in theirs. Yeah. The world needs that more than ever. I believe that at my core, that we need people who can express ourselves in a genuine way, our ideas in a way that matter, and create those connections with other people. Because I'm naive enough to believe that it's the connection that we're all craving to ourselves, to our work, to each other. And as Toastmasters, it's our ability to communicate and build those skills that allow us to do that. So if I leave you with anything, I hope you continue in Toastmasters, because it is a gift. And I'm sure that you have all seen that over the last several weeks. But to remember that your presence is also a gift. Your voice matters, your ideas matter. And the next time that you're walking down the street and you see something that you like, or someone who's got their head down, ask yourself, how can I blow them a kiss?
Stacy, of course, thank you for the gift of your presence here with us today. And now everyone knows why Stacy was at the top of our list to invite us on. That was fabulous. Speaking of gifts, there's something else that I think of as a gift. And what that is when someone is willing to share feedback with me. Even if it's feedback that's not a pat on the back, but a suggestion of how I might be able to do better next time. And that's been a very important part of the Speechcraft program. It's a very important part of Toastmasters. And so this next part of our meeting is the evaluation portion of the meeting. And we have a general evaluator who will be introducing to you the other members of the evaluation team, as well as sharing his own thoughts on how this meeting has gone today. So please help me welcome Paul Vermette II, our general evaluator.
Hey everybody, I'm Paul, not the three-eyed monkey that you know from Nickelodeon, and I'm going to be the general evaluator for today. So basically we're going to go and recap everything that just went on. So the first guest speaker that I would like for evaluation would be Dan, if everybody could help me welcome him. He is going to be covering Patrick's speech.
Hello
my name's Dan. I am going to be evaluating Patrick's speech on communication. I think I felt, as well as everyone else felt, that you were very well prepared. It was very well rehearsed, and you were very comfortable on stage, I felt. You presented multiple ideas very logically and slow enough for us all to follow and kind of consider how technology has affected our own forms of communication in life, and how it may have hindered or maybe in some cases helped certain other relationships. I know that we are a very social world now with Facebook and Twitter and all that stuff, so it has helped, I think, people over the years to come together from across continents and things like that, and just enhance that form of communication, but at home with relatives and things, it can, of course, cause problems there. So I feel like you articulated each form of communication very well. You appeared to become more comfortable as you went along. It was persuasive enough, I think, for us all to consider dropping our own technology, or at least for a day or a week at a time, enough to kind of understand how it is really affecting us. And I think your ability to go ahead and be a symbol of that is resilient, to say the least. So thank you for that. I would say the only thing I may have improved was to slightly enhance your emphasis in your voice at different portions to really show how it's affected you and affected your own relationship with your grandparents and people like that. Maybe make specific eye contact at certain points in the audience, just to drive those messages home. But overall, I really enjoyed the use of your cell phone or your imaginary cell phone to really kind of give us that interpretation of what we look like with our own bodies and body language throughout those interactions. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Dan. All right, we're going to go on to our second speech, where we have Johanna evaluating Christopher's. So please help me welcome Johanna.
Hi,
Johanna.
For this speech, I thought it was a very fun speech, very interactive. It involved the audience, and also we also had some props. Okay, for the topic selection, it did require a display of emotion, so he did have a lot of vocal variety. He was excellent in the preparation because he was able to pull the Toastmasters course together, but in order, and explain to us piece by piece how it affected him and what he learned from it. But I like the way that he actually had it in order, and also told us exactly who it was that gave what speech throughout the course. Volume of his voice, not too loud and not too low, so that was ideal. Speaking rate, there was a few times when he slowed down, but I think it was actually to catch up on where he was gonna go next. It wasn't something that was affecting his speech, his rate. His pitch was loud enough for us to hear, but still conversational. He was very confident with his topic, so that helped a lot with his tone. And for articulation, I don't think there was a time when I thought that I could not understand his pronunciation, so that was very clear. The variety was excellent. It changed as his speech changed. And his body language, satisfactory. I think there was times, in my opinion, that I'm not sure if it was part of the speech, but to me it looked like there was times that you could have been nervous, but that's natural, especially when we're learning. And again, the organization of the speech, great, because like I said, you put everything in order and it just worked for the speech. Thank you.
So, I just want to correct an error that I made. It was Kevin that gave that speech, not Christopher. Sorry, my notes are a little sloppy. Not the best penmanship. So, with that being said, our next evaluator is going to be Terrell, who is doing Davina's speech. Can you please welcome your husband?
I'm going to be giving a speech on time. I felt your speech flowed very well. You had good body language. I know we talked about your intro. I really didn't catch it. There was times when you was looking on the ground. I don't know if I'm in the sixth row or you was looking at them. So that was something I noticed. The volume of your speech was real well. Your rate, you spoke at a consistent rate. There wasn't that much emotion for me. I didn't know where you was really. You did use a few bridge words, but I wasn't sure if it was in your speech or you was trying to think about your speech as you was going along. Your organized speech, it was good. But overall, I think your speech was amazing. And I heard you speak a couple of times, so I know your speech is amazing.
All right. Our fourth evaluator is going to be Christopher, and he is going to be evaluating Cynthia's speech. So please help me welcome Christopher.
How are we doing, everyone? I'm Chris. First of all, I just have to say, like, wow. Honestly, like, man, over the course of like 1 to 6 weeks, like, this is just wild. How important and like how meaty and just the substance of what people spoke about. It's insane. It was really good. So on for Cynthia, just I think a super important topic, especially for family and everybody. And as you can see, when she was up here, she's like the Rock of Gibraltar. You would think she's been doing this her whole life, but then again, raising children kind of gives you that ability to do that and have that. But a very important subject, unconditional love, and powerful, three L's, laughing, listening, loving, and learning, all right there. And the singing, that was awesome. We all sing in the shower, but none of us dare do it in public, but outstanding. Voice was great. She very quickly used the word of the day, fired it right off in her speech. It just seemed very natural. Like I said, once again, very powerful topic selection, something that we could all spend some time dwelling upon. Definitely well prepared. She seemed very natural. It came easy to her to speak about this. Her manner, she seemed very confident, bold. Appearance, awesome as always. Good posture, carried herself well. I mean, I don't think anyone could not tell that she didn't exude confidence through every area of her speech. Gestures, good articulation, walking around a little bit, different vocal range and variety, vocal tone, good use of her hands and stuff when she was speaking. Different affect, how she changed the vocal ranges as the topics changed, but always coming back to the main topic of love. Great eye contact with everyone here, I felt. Facial expressions, perfect, wonderful smile, and it was just, you know, it was an overall pleasure. Her organization, I just thought it was great, it flowed well, and you know, I know there's always something you could say that you could have done better, or we're supposed to add our personal opinion of what we think we would have changed. I honestly don't think anything could have been changed in that. That was just outstanding. Great job, Cynthia.
And last but not least, our fifth evaluator will be Travis, and he is going to be evaluating Daniel Burton's speech. Can you please tell me what, Travis?
So, I didn't take a lot of notes because I thought you gave an amazing speech, and there was only... So, for your topic selection, it gave you a lot of room to be able to work with your vocal variety. Seemed very prepared. I can tell you rehearsed. Your voice volume was amazing. The only thing I'd say is try to think of how it carries through the room so that people in the back can hear you as well as the people in the front can hear you. And your speaking rate were amazing. Again, I was thinking still. So, and then with your pitch, And you did change it up, which is something you naturally do, so I expect it no less. And tone, again, you were amazing. And articulation, I didn't catch anything. And with your vocal variety, again, amazing. And you also normally talk with body language, so again. And for the only thing I'd say you need to work on is using your space. I know I'm just standing here, but it's when you're giving a presentation, you want to use as much space as you can to make sure that all eyes are on you.
All right, and that is it for our evaluation part. Next, we will have Amy Blanchette, who is our grammarian and also our word master. So can you please help me out coming in on
wasn't a hard meeting to capture everyone's grammar, whether it be good or bad. You actually all did pretty good. Ryan Levesque, you had one filler word, so. Ryan, for table topics, you had 7 ums. Daniel Borden, you had no filler words, but you used the word of the day 5 times, so you own it. That's our rule here at Toastmasters. You own that word of the day. Kevin, you had 1 filler word. That was it. You did amazing. Patrick, 5. Joanna, 20. Sorry. Cynthia, nothing, but you did use the word of the day once. Davina, 2 filler words. Paul, I honestly didn't catch. I was kind of paid attention to.
I'll go with 0.
Sounds good. Danny, 5, 10, 14 ums. Terrell, 5. I caught you with you was and a couple of times. Chris, A.
Yes.
13 filler words, and that was and like and Travis, 7 filler words. So and then. And anybody else use a word of the day? Ryan Levesque, he used it once as well. And that's it. Thank you.
And next will be our timekeeper, who is Allison. She can come right up if everybody can help me get her in.
Started a little bit late. We started at 2:07, 2 o'clock. So our introduction started obviously a little bit late. We did well. Ryan kept it going though, and he shortened up the introduction. We started table topics 4 minutes late at 2:14, and each speaker within that, they did a very good job of trying to keep their topics at about 5 minutes. There were a few that were really short, but that was expected. Stacy started speaking at 2:48, so just 2 minutes ahead of time, which is okay. And she spoke for 11 minutes and 50 seconds, which then placed us at 3 o'clock for the general evaluation by Paul. Each speaker evaluation took around a minute to 2 minutes, which is the expected time, which put us at a good spot. And Amy's started at 3:12, and it took a minute and 30 seconds.
I'm starting to think there's something wrong with my hand here. All right, so with that being said, I'm going to give my evaluation for the entire day so far. And like Allison just said, we started off at 2:07. But once that happened, everything went smoothly. Everything went according to plan. I would say that our guest speakers, too, did an amazing job. Thank you. It was very good. The introductions we had were very well formed. Everybody did the exact proper thing. It was incredible. Our table topics, I really enjoyed those topics. It was really interesting. You drew everybody in, and there were a few that were funny, so that was great as well. So, and then when we went to our speakers, every single speech I was drawn into. There wasn't one speech where I was spacing out, and I have ADD, so it happens pretty naturally. But I wasn't spaced out once with every single speech. Every single speech was phenomenal, if you ask me, from week one till now, the progression is ridiculous. So, and then with the evaluations, we did incredibly. I mean, I remember 2 weeks ago when we had our evaluations, it wasn't as well, because a lot of people were kind of afraid to tell people what they did wrong in a diplomatic way. But I saw a lot of progression in that today. So that's very good. And the time, you kept time very well, and you clearly kept grammar very well. So, and it was really fun. It was a really fun meeting. I mean, everybody's enjoying themselves right now. I don't see anybody at the edge of their seat that wants to go home. So in conclusion, I would say that from week one to now, I'm amazed. Like, I didn't think, in all honesty, that this meeting was going to go as well as it did today, but it was phenomenal, and I enjoyed every single part of it. So thank you. And with that, I'm going to bring back Ryan, our Toastmaster.
Thank you so much, Paul. Fantastic job. One of the qualities of a leader is that a leader has a vision. They get this picture in their mind of something that they see in the world that they think could be a little bit different. And the next person I want to bring up is CJ Ferry, who you all know as the program coordinator for Speechcraft here. And when CJ was still a new Toastmaster, and by the way, he's still a new Toastmaster as our club is only coming up on our second anniversary, he very early in the process learned about the Speechcraft program. And CJ had this vision, and he thought, I can just see Speechcraft going on at BCC, and I can see the value that it would bring to the student leaders there at the college. And I said to CJ, settle down there, Tiger. Let's get a couple speeches under our belts first. But CJ felt really strongly about this and felt strongly that our club, even though we were new and our members hadn't given a lot of speeches, that we'd still already gotten a lot of from the program and that there was a lot that we could pass on to others. And so it was from that vision that he had of bringing Speechcraft to BCC that we are all gathered here in this room today. And so as I welcome up CJ, please join with me in showing our appreciation for him as the program coordinator for Speechcraft. CJ Ferry.
I've seen in this group of participants since day one. I couldn't get you to tell me anything you wanted at that first session. And people were telling me from administration, they're used to doing this anonymously. They're used to doing this without having to face the person and let them know. And through the process of this program, you've taken one of the things that I've always said in my life and I learned. When you say it, you own it. And you all have taken that to heart. You can tell by your speeches, you can tell by your leadership roles, and you can tell by the activities you do here at Bristol Community College. I sent an email out this morning which said very clearly my feelings and what I believed. And the one statement I put in there was that this program and the Bristol Community College vision of changing the world, learner by learner, fit in hand. This is difficult for me, but I'll tell you, I've never been prouder in my life. You are a group of students, participants, and leaders that Bristol Community College and I am extremely proud of. With that, I'd like to call up Kathy Burns and Marion Laguardier.
I didn't know, so I sat in the way, way back.
Kathy and I were speaking about this months ago,
mm-hmm.
last year. And she says, well, look at it. We'll think about it. And then she handed it off to Marianne, who has been at every session, who has supported every one of you, and has actually supported my team as well. So in appreciation of that, Kathleen Burns, Director of Student Life, Marianne LaGuardiere, Assistant Director of Bristol Community College, for entrusting Fall River Innovators with the development of the student leadership team in recognition of outstanding support of Toastmasters International's communication and leadership program.
Since I've been witnessing your courage, you've given me courage too. When we started talking about this, it also is thanks to Amy Blanchett, one of our students. She was actually president of the Senate at the time, and as we asked some of the ambassadors, they didn't have any response that was positive, but we were resilient. We didn't give up.
Yeah.
We tried, we had a contract in place for the fall semester. Once again, it was very challenging, people's work scheduled, and we did not give up. We were resilient again, and we set it up for this semester. I have to thank my boss, Kathleen Burns, as well. She is the director here, and her vision was, we have ambassadors and we have senators who make BCC look fantastic.
Yeah.
They volunteer, they are the best of the best, while going to school, taking care of their parents, taking care of their children, and getting fantastic grades, but still wanting to do more. We wanted to give something back to them. And CJ and your whole team, we can't thank you enough. I am so proud of all of you. You've done fantastic. I don't know if I have the right to be proud. You're not my children, but I feel like you are fantastic. From the first week until this week, the difference in composure and how you articulate, how you have expressed deep thoughts that have made me so incredibly proud to be part of Bristol Community College. Thank you.
Stacy Shipman. Stacy, this is a small token of our appreciation. Stacy Shipman, DTM, for serving as our keynote speaker on the conclusion of the first Bristol Community College and Fall River Innovators in Speechcraft program. Your speech was amazing, and I want to express to you, and please take the message back to the district, that without the district's support of Fall River Innovators and these programs, we would not be here today. And I really want to thank you for your time. You came from Weymouth, I understand, not that far, but it was amazing, and I think the speech reached a lot of our participants.
Yeah, your presence was a gift here. And you know, just to piggyback off what Ryan said about leaders having a vision, I think one of the greatest gifts a leader can give is the opportunity for other people to develop their voice. And you've all done that, Marianne and everybody. So we appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I'm going to give some certificates to my leadership team. So first I would like to call up Sarah Arujo.
Are you going to have them all stay up there?
Yeah. Thank you for all your help, Sarah. Please stay.
Okay.
Derek Benjamin. Amy Blanchett. Thank you, Amy. Stephen Buchanan. Carlos Cesar. Sony Fernandes. Michael Madden. Michael also serves as my high performance leadership team coordinator. Oh, this guy. Ryan Levette. Ladies and gentlemen, the Speechcraft leadership team. Close ranks.
Ladies in the front.
Yeah,
you're
gonna have to
push
it all out.
Sure.
I am looking forward to.
Hey, look, please. One more. Thank you.
And now for the most important certificates. President Sprager, if I could ask you to come up here and assist me in presenting these completion certificates to your students. Nikisha Albert.
Stay up here, please.
Stay up. You
can
just
stay up. Ryan Arruda. Ryan, congratulations.
Thank you.
Christopher Azevedo. Karina Breton. Life gets in the way sometimes, I always say that. Daniel T. Borden. Cynthia Fenn Coley. Kevin P. Furtado.
Congratulations. There's a jack of spades in there.
Is that going to change on me? Davina Lara. Patrick Lever.
Congratulations.
Jeffrey Martin.
Jeffrey, congratulations.
Joanna Morales. Travis H. Webb.
Congratulations.
Daniel Rodriguez.
You never know. Dan, congratulations.
Adam Rose. Terrell Sanders.
Congratulations.
Allison Taylor. And Paul Spravets the second. Ladies and gentlemen, your Speechcraft participants and graduates.
Table.
You're the photographer for the college.
Well, I'm not a photographer, but I will be.
Hey, come on
so I need the people, the tallest in the back, and make multiple rows, please. And Dr. Sprague can step up front a little.
Okay, sure.
CJ, can you help them get organized, please? Get the shot on. Three rows.
It's going to be
interesting.
Okay, so. Five long, six long? Six long.
Yeah,
because
I can't.
Yeah. Okay,
yeah.
Yeah.
You can also go up front. What's that supposed to be, Chris?
No, I mean, there's the word I'm having to be short of.
I was going to say, I'll lose your knees.
Okay.
Is that okay?
You need to step in with the group because it's like you're not high. That's it. And
hold it up.
You can come you're a little bit shorter, so you come forward, okay, and you come closer.
Beautiful.
That's better. Okay. Excuse me. Okay, everyone, smile. Okay. Squeeze in a little, please. I'm trying not to get that door.
Hey, I'm gonna go in there.
Yes.
Yeah. 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 Kathy, you get in too. Then CJ has to get in.
Okay,
yes.
Yeah, CJ. Smile. 1, 2, 3. CJ, you just walked in.
You photobombed.
1, 2, 3.
I want to thank all of you for participating. As you've heard from several people today, you have all made tremendous progress throughout this entire program. I have spoken with the Office of Student Life. I've spoken to several students who are interested in Toastmasters, maybe creating a club here on campus. That's left to you, but we're here to help you. If you do indeed next semester decide you want to maybe look at opening a Toastmaster club on campus, reach out to me, we can reach out to the district, we'll make sure that it happens for you. What you've done here is only the start. And where you go with the school, the skills you've learned today and the skills you've learned over the past 6 weeks are up to you. I've given the story where I've met several of you prior to the Speechcraft program. Kevin, for instance, my first meeting with him was at the TV studio, was actually in the green room. And he was walking around, and I was wondering what he was waiting for, so I walked up to him and I said, what are you waiting for? And he was looking at the wall as he was talking. He was not looking at me. Today, he's up here in front of you, ripping off his shirt and changing cars. This shows you what happens when you have the confidence in yourself to speak and to lead. Those are not easy skills, but we all have them. It's just a matter of how do we develop them. And I can tell you now, I've seen it develop in all of you. Like a flower blooming in the springtime, what you've done is something you all should be very proud of. And I want to give all of you a great big round of applause. This has been a great program and a great experience for me. I hope it was a great experience for you. And now maybe you'll tell me to pound tar and get out of here, but that's besides the point. Thank you very much for your participation. And I wish you all the best in your future journeys in education. And remember, as President Sprague says all the time, changing the world, learner by learner. Thank you very much. Have a great night. Plenty of food and drinks down here, please help yourself to them.